you have trespassed. Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For that is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. We sing it. Amen.
church downtown. What's up, 1130? Turn to somebody, give them a holy high five or a holy fist bump.
Should have gone, come with it now.
That would have been awesome.
Are your ears freaking out?
Huh?
Are your ears freaking out?
No. Oh, no.
Right.
Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, now and forever. We feel your presence, Lord, and we ask be with us, surround us, move us, heal us, that we may feel your forgiveness. Said. Amen. Have a seat.
Hey, what's up? It's Sandrine, and it's time for this week's announcements. Starting out, John Witte has been here, and he'll be here for another week or so, talking about the good life. Well, this summer, John's going to take some time and come downtown and teach the good life course. And this is just a chance to extend what the talk that he's been talking about, figuring out what the good life is and what that looks like for you in your everyday life. It's a 7-week course. It'll start June 4th. If you're interested in that, we are doing registration in the lobby after service. It's $10 for this class, and you get a notebook, and it's lots of good information. So you want to be sure and check that out. Moving on, City Youth. City Youth is having a camp this summer, and this camp is going to be great. It'll be in July. It'll be our Bandera Road, downtown, and West campuses all together. So if you're interested, visit the website, sacitychurch.com. Registration is $25. The total camp cost is $155. Now, guys, don't let that number intimidate you. If you want to go to camp, but you don't think you can afford that, we do have scholarships available. So be sure to check that out. If you want more information, snag Carlos as you see him at City Youth. Lastly, you see Jesse and the band up here every week, and they do such an amazing job. But let me tell you, these guys get tired of being on every week. So we are now looking for musicians. If you play an instrument, guitar, bass, drums, the ukulele, if you're interested in trying out for the band, we're going to be having auditions May 19th. If you want more information, stop in the lobby. I've got some information cards for you. Or feel free to stop Jesse or one of the guys. Okay, I think that's it. It's good to see you. Have a great week. Bye.
Welcome to the good life. Welcome to the good life.
The wait is over.
I've stopped Jesse between the services and offered to, you know, try out for the band, and said, you know, Jesse, I just did that bumper right there. That was me. And he's not buying it. So I don't know if you can make the band or not, but if you'd like to, we'd sure like to have you. That was all in jest. You guys can laugh. I guess I'm not a comedian. Well, hey, watching the food bank video last week just, you know, reminded me of how we exceeded our goal, and it took me back a couple of years. I remember when our own Carlos Maestas 2 years ago asked me if I would take the food bank challenge, and they wanted to video some of it and things like that. And I know that what Carlos really wanted is he wanted to see a pastor suffer, and so he didn't tell me what the food bank challenge was. He just said, "Are you willing to take it?" And I said, "Well, yeah, okay, I'll take it." And so about a week later, he handed me this envelope, and it had $10 in it, and it was for me to eat on for 7 full days. That's 21 meals, right? And so I had $10 to eat on, and that seemed a little extreme, but I decided I was up to the challenge. And I had lived, you know, overseas with a lot of food insecure people for a long time. And so I knew what food insecure people did where I was from overseas. They just ate the same thing over and over again. And it's kind of a sure sign, actually, of poverty. And so if you're having a lot of variety in your diet, you're not poor, no matter what you think. And so I went to HEB, and I bought my stuff with $10. I bought a little bag of red beans, and I bought a bag of yellow maize meal, like you make cornbread out of or stuff like that. I bought 2 cans of diced tomatoes, a gallon of milk, an onion. And I bought three little bags of packets of ramen noodles for just in case. That was kind of my security blanket, you know? And that cost me $8.50, and I kept $1.50 in my, you know, wallet for just in case I ran out near the end of my 7 days. Well, what I did is I went home, and I made red beans African style, and then over the next 21 meals, 17 straight meals, I ate ugali, which is what a cornmeal mush that you make out of the cornmeal in boiling water. I ate ugali and beans for 17 straight meals. A little bit extreme. I missed a couple of meals. I think a friend took me out for one meal. I had a salad during all of that. I saw who my friends really were. They liked to see me suffer through the midst of it as well. Several things happened to me. First of all, in these extreme times, I lost my appetite on the 3rd day, okay? So every time it came mealtime, I thought, I'm not even hungry. I mean, and then I'd put one bite in my mouth, and it was, you know, like I just sucked it all down. I was starved to death and didn't realize it. The second thing that happened to me is I never daydreamed through the day about what I was going to eat because I knew what I was going to eat, right? I was going to eat ugali and beans, and some days I changed it up, and I had beans and ugali. And then I would drink a glass of milk, and y'all, milk is just sweet as all get out. I mean, it was like dessert, drinking a glass of milk. I was almost like eating ice cream, and I never even touched my ramen noodles. I was so satisfied with that. Well, I saved that $1.50, you know, and so at the end of the week when I had made my 21 meals, 7 days, I still had my $1.50 left over. I went down to Taco Cabana at happy hour. And you know, some of you know that they sell a few drinks down there for $1.50. I bought me one of those and celebrated. And the best thing about all of it is Carlos got pumped because he thought he was going to get me, and I got him, and so succeeded at this extreme food challenge that he couldn't even show my video to you guys. Instead, he had to show the video of Humby and Lauren. Y'all remember that one? Okay, you don't remember. All right, well. Well, you know, I admit that I might be a little bit extreme. I mean, 21 meals on $8.50, and I was determined to make it happen. But there's a reason for that. I've always felt like I had to go to extremes to get things right, because if I didn't, they might go wrong. And if things went wrong, that might create some pain for me. You know, when it comes to the good life, we'll do just about anything to get it. We will even go to extreme lengths. Some of us will even endure temporary pain to avoid the ultimate pain of not living the good life. Now, last week I showed you a chart about the good life, and I want to review that with you just real briefly today in case you missed it. You'll remember that the good life is when our routine, do we have those charts? Is when our routine and our relationships are characterized by a rest that only God can give. And what we saw from Genesis chapter 2 is we saw that under the category of routine, it involves our place, which is a place of peace, work that is meaningful and purposeful, and resources that are stable and abundant. Then, under the category of relationship, we saw that the key relationship in the good life is one in which we implicitly trust our lives to God, because God is the one who gives the good life. Then, if you're married, Then we saw that your spouse is loved and feels loved. And then out of that, everyone else who depends on you, your children, your extended family and friends, are able to depend on you for their life. Now, we saw also that our ancestors, our first ancestors, Adam and Eve, even though God had given them the good life, they were deceived to believe that they really couldn't trust God for their lives. And so remember I taught you they tried to take control of their own lives. And when they did, their lives were filled with pain. They were living in the red. You may have noticed that we're all wearing red t-shirts today. Alana even dyed her hair red just to, you know, go with the theme for the day. I don't know what color it's going to be tomorrow, but it's red right now. And I appreciate her doing that. And when we are living in pain, our place becomes a place of turmoil. Our work is merely a means to survive and pay the bills. Our resources become scarce. Instead of trusting God, we become a taker from Him. And as a result, we become takers from everyone else. And so our relationships, our closest ones, often devolve into pain. And those who need to be able to depend on us become very uncertain about their lives. This pain in our lives, we're calling today living in the red. And when we are living in the red, you and I are in danger of losing the good life. Because you see, our pain drives us. Pain drives all of us. And the question is, to what does your pain drive you? Now, I want to remind you, as we saw last week, that God never intended nor designed us to live in pain. When we read the Bible in Genesis chapter 1 and 2, in the beginning, we read that people were living the good life. And when we read it in the end, in Revelation 21 and 22, we see again that people are living the good life for eternity. And so the question naturally comes up, if they were living it in the beginning and they're living it in the end, can you and I live the good life in this messed up middle? When we're living in red, when we're living with pain in our lives, and that is the question that we're attempting to answer over these 3 weeks. How can we live the good life when we're living it in the messed up middle? Well, I want to say to us today that the answer to that question depends almost in total what you do with your pain. How you handle your pain whenever you are living in the red, what you do with it determines whether or not you will live the good life. In other words, this is really the fundamental question of the good life itself. And so you and I have got to get this. So let me just say it again. When you experience pain, when you're living in the red, the next decision you make is the crucial decision in your life and will probably determine the course of your life, whether or not you live the good life or not. It will either drive you to God, your pain will either drive you to God, or it will drive you to your gods, those things that you substitute for God in hopes that they will give you the good life. So this is really everything, and we can put it into one simple question. God or gods? God or gods? Your pain will either drive you to God or to your gods. And so every time you experience pain in your life, you need to learn to ask this fundamental question. Is this pain going to drive me to God, or is it going to drive me to my gods? Will you do the next right thing, or will you do something else? You see, this question of what you will do with your pain is the signature spiritual issue for every one of us. And here is why. If your pain drives you to God, even if it's hard, and it probably will be, even if you suffer during your time of pain, you can still live the good life because God is the one who gives the good life. The good life is when our routine and relationships are characterized by a rest that only God can give. And so if our pain drives us to God, our pain is driving us to the source of the good life. But if your pain drives you to your gods, those things you substitute for God in hopes that they will give you the good life, I'm telling you, I promise you today, you will end up disappointed and perhaps even devastated. And there's a reason. No idol, no little g god can bear the weight of divinity. You and I know this, don't we? Intuitively, we know this. Whenever our pain drives us to something other than God, even if we're not conscious about it, intuitively, we are afraid it isn't going to work. And that is why we fear that our gods will fail us. And it is that fear that our gods will fail us, that it may not work out right, that drives us to extremes. Now, the Bible has a word for going to your gods. When we go to our gods, the Bible calls this idolatry. And idolatry is a huge theme in Scripture. 190 times the Bible uses the words idol, idols, or idolatry. 190 different times in the Bible, it talks about this whole question of God or gods. In fact, one of the most common places that it does it is Exodus chapter 20. Let me read those verses for you there. This is God speaking through Moses to the Israelite people, and he said, "I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt." Watch this. "You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourselves an idol. You shall not bow down to them or worship them." Now, some of you might recognize these words. These are actually the first words of the Ten Commandments, a document that many people would agree has changed the course of Western civilization. Why would God make the opening words of that kind of a document that is so important? Why would he say the opening words, "You shall have no other gods before me"? Well, the Apostle Paul answers that question for us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. There, Paul said, "These things," talking about the events of the children of Israel, "these things happened to them and were written down for us as warnings for us." And then he states again, very plainly, "Do not be idolaters." I mean, God is really clear about this in the Scriptures. Why does he make God or gods the signature spiritual issue for every one of us? Well, I think there's a reason. I think a loving God warns us about going to our gods because he knows every idol will ultimately fail us, leaving us disappointed, extremely disappointed, because no idol can bear the weight of divinity. So let me ask you today, do you have any idols? Do you have any little g gods in your life? We might say, well, John, how do I recognize one? How do I know? What is an idol? Well, let me show you three just quick, simple characteristics of an idol. First of all, an idol is something or someone without which you think your life would hardly be worth living. So let me just say that idols are not necessarily bad things. Idols can be anything. It can be any created thing. So an idol is something that you thought, you would think, God, if I don't have that, my life wouldn't be worth living. What is that for you? Secondly, because you think you have to have that idol to live, secondly, You fear losing it. And so it's because of the fear of losing it that we often go to extremes. And then, since we don't want to lose it, it is easy for us to spend large amounts of emotional and financial resources on our idols. So let me give you three easy little questions you can ask yourself to help you identify if you have an idol. The first one is, what do you easily spend your money on to escape your pain? Now, you know, just some common ones for us might be spending money shopping, you know? Have you ever experienced it where you're just sort of depressed a little bit and you go out and you buy something and you feel better for a moment, but it doesn't last? Yes, John, we've all experienced that, right? I've experienced that, where you were kind of excited about what you got, but it quickly wore off. If that is a pattern for you, that might be an idol for you. It would also be a way to spend a lot of money in a hurry, wouldn't it? Maybe another idol would be something like just maybe our adult toys, you know, the kinds of big things we buy, plasma TVs, you know, boats, a brand new car when you already got three, you know, and really don't have a place to put that one, or, you know, just, oh, we're going to just completely change all my clothes, or maybe you've got like 80 pairs of shoes in your closet, or, you know, something like that. Or maybe it's something as simple and as ordinary as just eating out a lot. Even though maybe you really don't have the money to afford it, you just find yourself eating out all the time. So one way is just, where do you easily spend? How do you easily spend a lot of your money? A second way that you can identify your gods is whenever you have some free time. You know, you're not working, your mind doesn't have to be thinking about anything. Where does your mind drift? What does your imagination go to? What consumes your mind and your thinking? There was a time in my life when golf was an idol, and I would go back, like whenever the last time was I played, it could have been days before, and I would go back and in my mind, I would play all 18 holes over again in my mind. Okay, that's the kind of thing I'm talking about. Where does your mind go? That can be a sure indication of what an idol might be in your life. A third one is, what are you extreme about? What do you get extremely angry over? What do you get extremely depressed about? Our emotions, our extreme emotions, often get attached to our idols because we fear losing our idols, or maybe we actually did lose one. And so, as you can imagine with this list of questions, some of your idols are pretty easy to see. Some of them aren't so easy to see because they can often be good things or even another person. But here's what I want you to take away today. Whatever your idols are, our idols will always ultimately fail us because no idol can bear the weight of divinity. Now, I want to show you an example of this from the life of a biblical character by the name of Jacob. You may have heard the phrase before, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Jacob was a Bible hero in the middle chapters of the book of Genesis, and he was one of the founding fathers of the nation Israel. But Jacob's life, even though he was a Bible hero, his life was not all good. In fact, Jacob was not his father's favorite. His father actually loved his brother more than he loved Jacob. Not only that, but Jacob's name actually meant the crafty one or the deceiver. Now, how would you like to have a name that every time you went up and introduced yourself to someone, you said, "Hi, I'm a deceiver." And you lived up to it, right? And I mean, how would you... So Jacob did live up to it, because on two different occasions, he deceived his brother out of some really valuable blessings and property. And as a result of that, his older brother had vowed publicly that whenever their father died, he was going to kill Jacob. Can you imagine living under that kind of pressure? And so Jacob had to flee for his life from his own home and his own family, and he fled to an uncle where his mom had grown up named Laban. Jacob came to one of those painful, living in the red moments where his next decision would determine the course of his life. Would his pain drive him to God, or would it drive him to his gods? Now, in this painful condition, you know what Jacob did? He jumped at the first thing that came along that he thought would relieve his pain. And her name was Rachel. And the Bible gives us some really interesting reasons for that. Rachel was the second-born daughter of that uncle that he ran away to save his life, to live with him. And the Bible tells us why Jacob may have jumped at Rachel. The scripture tells us, not directly, but indirectly, that Rachel was an absolute bombshell. All right? If you don't know what that means, she was drop-dead gorgeous. And do you guys ever remember watching cartoons when you were little and you know, the cartoon character would see something that kind of amazed him and his eyes would bug out? You remember that? I think maybe that's what happened to Jacob here. He saw Rachel and she was so gorgeous and whoa, his eyes bug. And Jacob may have thought to himself, man, if I could just have Rachel, my life might be worth living. And so Jacob's pain drove him to Rachel, and Rachel became his little g god. Now, you know, this may sound really romantic at first. A man smitten with love. But I want to tell you, the results of this were anything but lovely. The results were an absolute disaster because Rachel became an unhealthy obsession for Jacob. To begin with, Jacob's idol cost him way too much. Here's what I mean by that. In those days, it was common that if a man wanted to marry a woman, he had to buy her from the family. And so that was an ordinary part of the culture in those days. But Jacob worked, we're told, he worked 14 years total to marry Rachel, which was four times the going rate to buy a wife. This expense put him in debt and was unwise. You know, part of the good life is that our resources will be stable and abundant. And one of the things that we just generally believe is that God is a loving heavenly Father and that He gives to us what we need to live a stable life in terms of our resources. But Jacob, whenever he paid four times the price for his idol, it created financial trouble for him, and it often does the same thing for you and me. In fact, if your finances are often out of, you know, order and out of sorts, and if you find, I just never have enough to live, it could be that it's one of your idols that is actually draining away your money and your resources. But not only did Jacob's idol cost him too much, believe it or not, it got worse than that. Jacob's idol actually made him kind of stupid. Let me tell you what I mean by that. Jacob had worked 7 years to marry Rachel. Finally, his wedding night came. Okay, guys, you all remember that? Okay. His wedding night came. Well, when he went in, you know, to spend the night with Rachel for the first time, his father-in-law substituted the firstborn daughter, the less lovely Leah, for Rachel. And Jacob didn't realize it till the next morning. Now, let me just say, isn't electricity a great thing? Okay. Well, when he realized, some of you just now, okay. When he realized that he had been deceived, he stormed in to see his now father-in-law. And he said, "Why did you do this?" And the father-in-law said, hang on. You know the culture around here. You know that Rachel, the second born, she can't get married until the firstborn is married. So I had to give you Leah first so that you could have Rachel. And if you'll just work 7 more years for me, you can have both of them. So Jacob's idolatry actually ended up blinding him to the obvious. And now he had 2 wives and was indebted to his father-in-law for 7 more years. You know what? Most of us in this room today, we're actually pretty smart people, aren't we? Isn't it amazing how smart people do stupid things? You know, why do we do that? I want to suggest to us that one of the reasons we do it is because our idols hold out for us that they will give us a good life, even though they really can't, even though they will always fail us. And so whenever we are in pain and we have this belief that our idols, okay, my idol's going, this thing is going to give me the good life, we're able to believe things and be deceived in ways that we normally would not. And that's what happened to Jacob, and it happens to you and me as well. So let me ask you today, why does God let us go through pain and devastation in pursuing our gods? Why didn't God just blow the whistle and say, okay, time out. I thought you guys were all smart enough to get it, but since you're not, stop. Quit going to your gods, and when you're in pain, just come to me. Why doesn't he do that? Well, you know, in a sense, that's sort of what he's doing with these 3 weeks of me being down here with you. Maybe he's using my voice to help you see that today. But if we don't listen, then you know what God does? He lets us pursue our gods until they fail us again and again. Has that ever happened to you? Maybe you're in the middle of it right now. Let me give you some good news. You know what the good news is in all of this? While you and I are pursuing our gods, the one true God is pursuing us. And you can be sure that in his pursuit of us, he will not relent.
Set you as a seal.
won't relent until you have it all. My heart is
God wants you and me so much that he even lets us pursue our gods until finally they fail us. And that pain in our lives that our gods could never quench, we finally let us drive. It drives us. We let it drive us to him. You know what? God knows you. He knows where you have been. He knows the gods that you have served. He knows the gods that have failed you. He knows the pain in your heart. What I'm asking of you and myself this weekend is for us to let that pain drive us into a pursuit of him. Here's what I mean by that. You know, to be honest with you, for the last few months, my life's been rocking along pretty well. On Friday morning, my day off, around 7 o'clock, Linda came in from work. She'd been working all night. And she walked in. I could tell something wasn't right. And she told me about a conversation she had had with one of my kids. And as soon as she told me about that conversation, it's like somebody hit me in the solar plex when I wasn't looking. You know that feeling? When all of a sudden your stomach is nauseated and your mind begins to race a million miles an hour. And I'm telling you, y'all, what I wanted to do is I wanted to get up out of my chair right there. I wanted to take a tight grip on it. I told you last week, I know how to do that. I wanted to manipulate things and make things work just the way I thought they should work. Pain was kind of coursing through the veins in my body. And all of a sudden, I had to decide if these words that I'm saying to you are just words or if I really believe them. That pain, is it going to drive me to God or is it going to take me to my gods of making things work? I want to say to you, honestly, in that moment, as Linda was talking to me, and as she's sort of waiting, what do we do? What do we do? I said, honey, there's only one choice for us to make. We're feeling pain, but we have to let it take us to God. And so that's what we've done. We've spent the weekend on our knees, driving in the car, talking to God out loud, saying, Lord, this hurts. And all we know to do is to come to you and wait on you to accomplish whatever you want to accomplish in it. And so that's what I'm asking you to do. When pain comes into our lives, as it all inevitably does, instead of driving us to our gods, let it take us to God. So would you pray with me? Let me help you. Let's just pray that prayer right now. Father, we thank you that you know us. You know us better than we know ourselves. Lord, we absolutely confess again today as a group together that you are the one true God. You're the only one great enough to handle our pain. You're the only one, of course, able to give us the life that we all seek. And so, Father, as best we know how, right now, with the pain that we came into this building with today in our lives, and I'm sure it is much, Lord, we want that pain to drive us on a pursuit of you. And as we pursue you, and Lord, as you pursue us, I pray that we might meet you face to face. And that you would change us and make us into the people you want us to be. Lord, we commit ourselves to pursuing you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And everyone said together with me, amen. Hey, y'all, All this year, we've been saying, if you really want to pursue the good life, it's time plus the next right thing leads to the good life. And maybe for you, the next right thing would be to join me in that course I'm going to be teaching beginning in June. I wrote it. It's good. Okay, I'm not bragging. It's good. I wish you would join. I'd just love for 50 or 75 of us to get together and do that course together for 7 weeks. You can sign up out in the lobby today. And hope you'll take advantage of that. Also, we always have prayer counselors here. If you came in with some pain today and we could serve you by praying with you about that, we'd like to do that. And then I want to say thank you to all of you who have been faithful this year in your giving and your generosity. We have a few ways to do that. We have a box right here at the back row. We also have giving kiosks. You can pay with your credit card outside, or you can give online just like I do at sacitychurch.com. Thank you for doing that, for making what we do a possibility. And this week, as you leave, one question just all week long, God or gods? You guys have a good week. Be good. We'll see you next week. Thanks for being here.
Swallowed by pride, everything.